first ever student life coordinator, Tom Hay embraced this opportunity designed to promote a sense of school spirit. It was an experiment this year, and it worked. I won't claim that every idea, every announcement, and every game was a brilliant success. But I will attest to Tom Hay's desire to do the right thing. His leadership on the stage every morning was overt, and his leadership in other areas of school life contributed significantly to the community. No matter the medium, Tom surmounted the numerous obstacles presented by the challenge of this new office and was a key ingredient to the success of this school year. Please join me in welcoming our first student speaker, Tom Hay.
Spring and summer are my favorite parts of the year. The amount of growth and new beginnings these seasons allow can be overwhelming. We are here now at one of those moments that allows for growth. These moments allow us as a community to reflect on the past and on our past accomplishments. We've all made the decision to take our arts, sports, dances, and academics to the next level by attending this preparatory school at Berwick Academy. We are being prepared to handle college. As you know, the seniors were given the opportunity to do a project for the last 2 weeks of school. And during that time, my parents decided that since I wasn't at school, they would put me to work. Like many of you, my job for the summer is to cut the lawn. I actually don't mind cutting the grass at all, and it is to me, as shoveling snow is for Mr. Fletcher, it's our zen activity. My ears are filled with the hum of the motor, and with nothing to think about, my mind is free to wander. However, with a speech to write, my senior project still to do, and other deadlines where I must be here at Berwick High School slowly crept into my head as I am manicuring my lawn. To make sure that I don't miss any parts of the large and expanding lawn that I have, I mow the front, the side, the back, and the extra parts in that order. I sometimes wish that my home had a 5x10 patch of grass. That is not the case. And this job that stands in my way of enjoying a sunny day will take me over 3 hours. The biggest part of what makes mowing a lawn fun are the sit-down mowers when you can cruise around having a blast while still getting work done. My mower is not a sit-down mower. I have a push mower that has a bag attached to it to collect everything that is cut, and if you don't empty the bag when it's filled, it typically detaches from the mower, spraying me in the face with grass. The front of the lawn is the first thing that people see when they get to my house, and it has a sloping hill that is flanked on both sides with thorn bushes. For some reason, I always pick this part to do first, and as I make the first few passes on the lawn, I begin to remember all the tricks and trades that I used to use from last year, and by the time the back of my mower is filled with freshly cut grass, I take a look back on what is just cut, and there is a line of grass, one blade thick, standing 2 inches above the rest, that I missed. Obviously, I'm a little rusty. These patches of grass I carelessly missed can be easily patched up with a trimmer or another pass of the mower. But I don't clean it up. I continue to mow the lawn. And like I said, mowing the lawn is my zen activity, and I really don't mind doing it. Although the act of emptying the bag is time-consuming and annoying, it must be done. Fortunately, my side yard is a perfect rectangle with nothing in the way. However, my dogs like to play in the side yard, and they constantly leave any possible combination of tennis balls, chew toys, sticks, and or frisbees. Before I cut this side of the grass, I must clear the lawn of all the things in the way. No matter how hard I try, every single time, I can search long and hard over every single square inch, yet time and time again, I still hit one stray toy. And again, I must empty the bag every 2 or 3 passes, but the lawn is very straight, so I have little trouble. The backyard is a love-hate relationship for me. It's a small yard, but it is riddled with the most things in the way. Anything from dogs, chickens, guinea hens, which look a lot like chickens, flowers, flower pots, buckets, a sauna, and of course, dog toys. If all that extra stuff wasn't in the way, this would be the easiest part of the lawn to cut, but that again is just not the case. Since the backyard is smaller, I only have to empty the bag of grass a few times. As the backyard is done, at this time I think I'm finished with the lawn, until my mom informs me that I still have to cut the part in front of my car and a little area by the woods that we have. There are no toys in these spots because they are located outside of my dog's invisible fence. The first section only takes a short while, and now that it is done, I must push the mower across the yard to the last part. Fortunately, my mother and father have planted apple trees every 3 feet, and I must mow around them, making my job a lot harder. Not wanting to kill the trees, I keep focus. But not wanting to mow the lawn anymore, I lose focus. However, the pride of creating something that I can look at and associate myself to directly keeps me going. By now, I bet a lot of you are wondering, where's this going? My freshman year is my front lawn. The sloping hill and thorn bushes were just as hard to deal with as the academic workload switching from middle school into upper school. During my first year in the upper school, I had opportunities to fix the patches of grass that I missed, but for some reason, I did not capitalize on those opportunities. The simple act of mowing the lawn, to me, is a lot like school. Every pass you take across the lawn is another day following bells at school and doing work in hopes of cutting the entire lawn, even when that seems out of reach. I like cutting grass, and I'm even willing to deal with the emptying of the bag every few passes, just like I'm willing to do homework every night, because it is an essential part of our job as students. The side yard to me is my sophomore year. Now comfortable with my surroundings and my teachers, the academic challenges resemble a nice clean triangle for me to mow down and digest. However, for me, there were a lot of dog toys in the way. While mowing, no matter how hard I tried, I still ended up running over a tennis ball here and there. In school, I had other impediments in my way that ended up sending me right to Mr. Smith. Either being late for school, late for class, or playing football during study hall, I hit a lot of tennis balls. The backyard is my junior year, a misleading area. A small yard riddled with challenges ranging from searching for colleges, sports, the junior paper, and other large projects that you can be assigned. The homework load is not as much, but there are things in the way that you have to overcome and watch out for that are overwhelming. Just as I thought all my challenges were over now that junior year is done, my mother, my father, my peers, and my teachers informed me there's one more year ahead. Looking at senior year as a junior, I saw a lot of different things. With all the impediments out of the way, I matured enough to take a role in student government, and I could see the challenges that it would pose for me for the next year. I also saw a large reduction in the workload, which turned out not to be true. Now, the problem with mowing the last part of the lawn is that you can see all the work that you have already done, and you can already see what is left. It is very easy to rush and slack off, but every few feet there's another apple tree reminding you of the growth that you have made from your first pass on the lawn and your first class here at Berwick. On my second to last pass on this section of the lawn, I missed a patch of grass, and without even thinking, I wheeled around that mower and I cleaned it up. So beyond the challenges and the academics, the big thing that I saw that senior year could do is to allow myself to grow and mature in new situations and try some new things. This year, I was able to be a captain of a varsity sport, be a key player in another varsity sport, was given the opportunity to stand in front of the community 4 times a week to begin the school day, and more importantly, I was able to grow a mustache. Although this ceremony and those to come are celebrating our graduation from high school, it would be wise to look ahead and see what lawns must be cut in the near future. If high school is my lawn, then college must be the outfield at Fenway Park. Only after batting practice, and you will get fired if you hit one of the baseballs. College will pose a lot of challenges for everyone here. I'm not concerned about anyone in our class, but please allow my high school career to be a wise warning and inspiration to those enrolling in September. Don't let the terrain get the best of you. Make sure that your freshman year looks a lot more like a 5x10 patch of grass instead of a hill leaning in thorn bushes. No matter if you are a freshman, sophomore, junior, or senior, don't let the tennis balls and dog toys get in your way. Make sure that you clear all distractions that in college can be devastating before you try to approach the challenges ahead. For most of us, this will be our first time living away from home for this amount of time, and the amount of responsibility being thrust upon our shoulders can be a great and heavy weight. If you don't allow the grass to pile up and you empty the bag when you should, clear the lawn and find a nice flat area to work with, then college will be as easy as mowing your lawn for only 3 hours.
Lassie has been a faculty member at Berwick Academy since 2007. Born in Montana, Mr. Lassie and his family moved to Bow, New Hampshire when he was 2 years old. He graduated from Concord High School and received his bachelor's degree from the University of New Hampshire in political science and international affairs. After graduation, he became an assistant outdoor education counselor at Winnicott High School and eventually landed at Brewster Academy in 1998. For 9 years, Mr. Lassie taught history, coached lacrosse and Nordic skiing, and led outreach trips to Haiti. In addition to all of these responsibilities, Mr. Lassie also took classes at Plymouth State University and earned his master's degree in education. At Berwick, Mr. Lassie has immersed himself into the culture. The respect he has earned from the students in the classroom and the athletic field speaks volumes about his character and passion. We are also fortunate to experience his talents as a member of our famous faculty band. It's pretty magical to hear him on stage with his harmonica, and although I expect he may have left his harp at home this evening, I would encourage you to jump at the chance to hear him play. He's quite talented. Before we hear Mr. Lassie speak, I thought it might be nice to point out a characteristic that he shares with many members of the class of 2009. As you all know, we have a student dress code. On most days, I would say that the students do a pretty good job of living up to the spirit of our rules, and I would say the same about Mr. Lassie. He's not particularly comfortable in a tie, but usually he does a pretty good job. However, in the same way that students scurry away from Mr. Smith or Ms. Onken when not in dress code, Mr. Lassie exhibits the same scurrying when he sees me coming and he's not in the faculty dress code. In fact, he was at the lower school lunch this week during our exam period, a day when everybody was supposed to be in dress code. When asked by a colleague from the lower school why he was eating lunch with them, he replied, and I quote, "I'm desperately avoiding seeing Saliba so he won't bust me for being out of dress code." Tonight, I am relieved to see that under his gown and hood, he indeed has a tie on, and we are very honored to present to you our 2009 faculty baccalaureate speaker, Mr. Peter Lassie.
In truth, I was blown away, speechless, that after 2 years at a school so steeped in tradition, you would choose me to deliver this message. What I needed to think about, Kim, aside from what poignant, funny, and inspirational words I should deliver, was why. Why did you all choose me? I thought about it. And the first thing that jumped to my mind was what every teacher hopes to believe. You must think I have something important to say. I thought, I must have really reached you. Upon more careful reflection, however, it occurred to me that maybe you were all simply curious as to what I would do or say up here. Will he trip and not go with the wind? Perhaps you wondered, see, this senior class has seen me at my best and my worst. Not only have they seen me genuinely excited and enthusiastic about what I teach, but they've seen me damage classroom equipment in the process and even cause myself physical harm. I'll never forget one day last April. It was early on a Monday morning, and the topic was Teddy Roosevelt's foreign policy. Emphasize a point, or maybe it was simply to reach the top of Mr. Fletcher's whiteboard, but I decided to stand on that chair, as I launched into what I thought would be a fervorous discussion of human rights, self-determination, and the rule of law. That chair gave way and sent me crashing to the floor, tearing a hole in my pants, and bruising more than just my ego. What followed was a stunned silence. Few questions concerning my well-being, and a feeble attempt to regain my composure and reignite discussion, now safely seated behind the end of the table. After a free period, however, and a new pair of pants, I delivered the same lesson to my C period class, this time with equal fervor, but with both feet firmly planted on the ground. So you can see why I was concerned with the motivation behind my nomination. Therefore, class of 2009, parents, colleagues, to allay any fears as to what will happen here tonight behind this podium, I have asked Mr. Saliba, to clear the stage of any errant chords on my trip over. I can promise I won't be standing on any chairs, and I've carefully prepared my words to avoid any embarrassing slips of the tongue. To those of you hoping for a pratfaller too, I apologize, but the night is still young, and I do have many pages to get there. I am honored to be here, not only because of the importance of this occasion and how flattered I am that you chose me for whatever reason, but because you, the class of 2009, will always stand to me as one of the most important, professionally and personally. It was on a September morning when, heart pounding, palms sweating, and voice stammering, I introduced myself to you as your new history teacher. Not only were you my introduction to Berwick Academy, but we met at a time of great crossroads in my career. Prior to arriving on campus 21 months ago, I had been at one school for 9 years. I had been teaching the same subject for 6 and coaching the same sport for 8. I had my curriculum down and my lacrosse practices were tight. I came here with preconceived notions about teaching and coaching and about high schoolers in general. I was not prepared, however, for the education you were about to give me. Over these past 2 years, you have forced me out of my comfort zone to rethink and extend how and what I teach. And you challenged most of those preconceived notions I had. My experiences here, professionally and personally, have been both liberating and, as I've just described, somewhat frightening. It is as if for the past 2 years I have been teetering high up on that chair in fog or mate, trying to keep my balance, trying to reach as high as possible, occasionally falling down, but always landing in a better place. In short, you have helped me become better at my chosen profession, and for that I am eternally grateful. And because of you, I find myself in this unique position of offering the final words from this esteemed faculty to deliver the final pieces of advice and wisdom we feel will help you in your future endeavors. It's somewhat ironic that you chose me, as I am probably the teacher here who likes to hear himself speak the least. I've always been more interested in listening and responding to what you have to say. But since we can't hold an informal debate on the content of my speech, there's no assigned reading to react to and discuss, and thankfully there will be no blogging to evaluate the merits of my words. You are my captive audience, and I'm going to take this opportunity to tell you what I would have wanted to hear and understand when I was your age just 18 years ago. What can I say, however, that hasn't been said already? You have spent 12 years absorbing information and advice. You've taken ethics classes. You've discussed great literature. You've pored over mathematical equations and proofs. You've conducted scientific inquiries. You've read Benjamin Franklin's autobiography. You've lived like Thoreau, or at least try to. You've even dropped eggs from 3 stories to see if you can rescue them from annihilation. What what can I tell you in 10 to 12 short minutes that you don't already know? Often you'll find in talks like this, speakers rely on quotes from authors, philosophers, politicians, and other historic figures. We like them because they offer in a line or two succinct wisdom, advice that has guided or challenged civilizations for centuries. We expect you to recycle this wisdom and shape it into your own personal philosophy or worldview. In fact, isn't that what a high school education is meant to do? To give you the useful knowledge that you can build upon. I will, like others, rely on a quote to guide my message and capture some wisdom in two lines. But unlike most other quotable phrases, you won't find this one on a bumper sticker, nor will it grace the walls of the library. It is not elegant or even eloquent. To me, however, it means everything. I didn't Google it for this search, for this speech, nor did I look it up on Marvel, though I know all of you can. No, I found this particular piece of wisdom in a book, a political philosophy text from my freshman year at UNH, and it's been my mantra ever since. Okay, I can already hear the groans. Here goes Mr. Lassie. He's getting political again. I wish he'd just knock something over already so we can have a good laugh. To those of you groaning, or even twittering, I promise you, I'm not here to preach a political agenda, but to explore the very nature of life and a life well lived. The author was a Spaniard, José Ortega y Gasset, a humanist philosopher who fled Spain during Franco's fascist reign to Argentina, where he continued to write and influence liberal thinkers. To live, he wrote, is to feel ourselves fatally obliged to exercise our liberty. I told you it wasn't particularly elegant, nor is it particularly original. You can find a rendition of these words on quite a few license plates out in the parking lot as we speak. Beyond live free or die, what does this mean? Liberty, I know, is and has been a very politically charged word. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Liberty and justice for all. It's ingrained in our culture, our humanity, and our history. Some would die for it, some would kill for it. In fact, 20 years ago, yesterday, hundreds of Chinese protesters gave their lives in its name. Some say its foundation rests upon disobedience, others upon imagination. Some, interestingly, describe it as a tree. I won't quote you Webster's dictionary definition of liberty for fear of evoking Mr. Connolly's wrath, but I will tell you that it means more than the rights guaranteed in the Constitution. To Ortega, it was personal liberty, freedom from conventional thought, freedom from societal, and yes, even familial expectations. Not only are we obliged to exercise our liberty, but according to Ortega, it is as if our life depends on it. To live a rewarding life, we need to search deep within ourselves and do what our soul tells us is right. Now, this may seem weighty for such an occasion, and from the title of my speech, you might think I'm advocating some kind of individualist, selfish philosophy, but I'm not. Honestly, I chose the title Taking Liberties because my wife Lisa told me it sounded better than Exercising Liberties. First one was born. And Peter Saliba did give me a deadline, I had to. Taking Liberties, however, has an entirely different meaning. If you were on campus this past May, whether it was watching a rousing game of croquet on Frog Field, or to experience the shenanigans at morning assembly, it's clear this senior class has been taking a few liberties. Exercising them, though, is too early to tell. Taking liberties means just that, taking and not necessarily giving back. To be sure, my message is not that the meaning of life is to simply do what you want when you want for your own personal amusement or a cheap laugh. For when you take liberties, you may be taking them from someone else. To exercise your liberty means much more. It means to act upon or to train for a higher purpose. It requires that you think differently, that you question conventions, that you extend yourself beyond what is comfortable or simply amusing. In fact, it's like unashamedly parking your 1986 Volkswagen bus in a sea of BMWs, because that's all you have to drive. But it's more than that, too. It's finding your own solution to a proof in mathematics. It's playing with, or even ignoring, meter and rhyme to write your own poetry. And it's creating a literary magazine to publish in it. It's also deciding to be the first redheaded woman on the Supreme Court. done before. It's taking the initiative to create a new student government position or a composting program. It's being the head of school and wailing on your electric guitar in front of your student body. And yes, Tom, it is growing a sweet mustache. In short, exercising your liberty is standing on that chair in fog, reaching for the top of your own whiteboard. Now, to underscore that I'm not here to tell you to do what you want when you want, there is a catch, a second equally important piece of wisdom from Senor Ortega. To live, he said, is to exercise our liberty. But then he adds, and to decide what we will be in this world. It's not enough to challenge convention, to think and act freely. Our obligation to ourselves, our happiness, our society even, is to find a niche, to fulfill an inner calling, and to be of some use. Have we prepared you for this? It has been our goal. We, now your former teachers, decided, and some of us perhaps are still deciding, what we will be in this world. And that extends well beyond being the teachers of the six disciplines. We are mothers and fathers, poets and journalists, artists and artisans, craftsmen and carpenters. We're musicians, both professional and amateur. Painters, both of houses and of art. We have served as veterans of the armed forces and the Peace Corps. We are disciples of a church and of Bob Dylan. We are Red Sox fanatics and fans of that other team. We are engineers and mountaineers, fishermen and fish fans. We're philosophers and meteorologists, scientists and environmental activists, triathletes and bicycle mechanics, Francophiles and Anglophiles, atheists and deacons, bleeding hearts and hardliners, and at least one of us attended Woodstock. Take from our experience. Build upon the foundation that we have helped you lay. Surely the world today is much different from when Ortega wrote his treatise. The threats to our liberty are no longer fascist dictators, but extremism, financial woes, and environmental decay. In the 18 years since I first read his words, however, the options available to you have grown more numerous and the pathways to them more accessible. What has remained the same is that tomorrow, when you walk across that stage, whether you fully recognize it or not, you will be more free to exercise your liberty than at any time in your life. How will you exercise it? When you trip on a mislaid cord or lose your balance, how will you respond? Where will you land? Tomorrow, after walking across that stage, you will sit down with your fellow graduates of the class of 2009. It will be your page to write upon and your journey to begin. Of course, my final advice is a question, a simple one, yet utterly complex, beautiful, and exciting. What will you decide to be? Good luck, and thank you.
Thank you.
and see someone coming through their doorway.
Well,
thank you, Emily and Dan. It's my pleasure to introduce this year's student body president as our next speaker. Elisa Morris has faithfully and tirelessly served the entire upper school this year. She embraced her role with passion and purpose and executed her responsibilities with alacrity. From day one, I was impressed by her ability to advocate for student-based initiatives, even if the initiative was not a passion of hers. Elisa is able to generate ideas, organize her classmates, and execute a logistical operation that makes the Army seem like a bunch of amateurs. Please join me in welcoming our next speaker, Elisa Morris.
Say thank you to your peers, your faculty, and your families. Flights are filled with smooth air patterns and those that cause turbulence. Both can only better prepare us for future flights ahead. Tomorrow, our flight will land, and we will soon arrive at our next terminals or our next flights. And as a member of this class, I would like to thank you for the smiles, the support, the laughs, and those tears while flying aboard Berwick Academy Flight 2009alongside of me. I wish you the best of luck in your next flight to whichever part of the world it may bring all of you. Thank you.
This evening is Senior Class President Kim Warnick. This year, Kim was the heart and soul of her class. She worked hard, she played hard, and through her actions, she personified much of what we teach here at Berwick. In fact, after recently defining our core values, I'm convinced that instead of spending a year in meetings, debates, and heated arguments, we should have simply looked at her. Kim upholds the highest standards of excellence, integrity, and engagement. If you balance all of these attributes and add a dash of humor, not only have you captured our new core values, but you have captured the essence of Kim Warnick. Ladies and gentlemen, Kim Warnick.
Montana.
he screams.